Well, Dennett's very clever, and I appreciate the, you know, the quickness of his mind. But I think his starting points are wrong. He's starting from a materialist point of view, trying to fit the mind into a kind of computing machinery model. It's curiously old-fashioned, and in his book Consciousness Explained, he says at one stage, I'm not going to discuss recent advances in physics, new discoveries about the nature of matter. I'm not going to bring those in at all. I'm going to talk about it in traditional scientific terms. So he's really rooted himself in the old debate of Cartesian dualism versus materialism, and I don't think really escapes from it. I think he's still, for all his cleverness and for all his intricate examples, I think he's still trapped within that, and I don't think he'll be able to break out of it.
Well, I think it'll be very interesting to meet him, because he is also so concerned with higher mental functions and consciousness. I come at this in a way as a biologist. I think he may come as a philosopher. I wonder whether there will be any point of agreement or reconciliation between us or not.
Daniel Dennett.
A colleague of mine up at Tufts, he's much too committed to strict Darwinian adaptation. Somehow we got to broaden him out to understand how rich evolutionary theory is, but he's got a lot of interesting things to say about intelligence and consciousness. But we got to work on him.
He's a philosopher, and so I'd like to maybe to ask does science make a difference to you? I mean, you know, is it important for you to know whether the universe is finite or infinite? And I mean, as a philosopher, is that the kind of question you want to know the answer to?
Dennett, I look away from you because he does seem to me to be the brightest, in some ways, the most interesting people of the people who are still stuck in the old groove. I mean, this whole cognitive science trade seems to me to be one more theoretical artifact which we didn't need. And I don't think it focuses on the problems of mind in a way which is, in the long run, going to make them any the more soluble. It's just going to keep people in the business of trying to reconcile our everyday understanding of psychology with an out-of-date view of physics.
It's Mix 98.5. Have you ever choked on a Cheez-It? Well, I just did, and your eyes turn red. Your face turns blue. Well, that's my story for the day. Here's Eric Clapton.
You know my name.
Hij heeft een huis in Noord-Andover en een farm in Maine, waar hij landbouw bedrijft, kalver doorstookt en 's nachts de coyotes hoort huilen.
My friend, you who claim to know me, look around my room. Nothing of its decoration was my own choosing. Open my wardrobe, it has nothing to show you that is specially me. My lover and dog know how I caress them, but I remain unknown to them. My old instrument is well aware of my hand's contours. It too cannot sing about me. Yet I am not in hiding. Simply, I do not exist. I act, I suffer as all men do, but my essential core is non-existence itself.
Hij leest op mijn verzoek een van mijn lievelingsgedichten, van Zaandor Wörish.
My friend, you must not regard me as having secrets. I am as transparent as glass. How then do you imagine you can really see me? Ah, yes, there's much in that that I love, that I think is right. And then, but there's also some suggestions that I would disagree with. Do we have secrets? Yes. In fact, having secrets is a very essential part, very essential. It's an essential part of being a human being. It's in secrets that language plays its big role. A secret is not only something that I know that you don't know, it's something that I know that you don't know that you don't know, and that I can control that fact. And it is only in that sort of control of knowledge that many of the things that human beings can do make sense. So, no, I am not transparent as glass. I have many secrets, and so do you. Yet, I agree that in another sense, I am not in hiding. I do not exist. Or rather, I am the sum total of all the behaviors, all the actions that I perform. I'm not something other than that, some secret thing other than that. But in those actions, I can conceal a great deal if I want to. And to some extent, I do, and so do you, and we should. And I guess I disagree with, you know, my lover and dog know how I caress them, but I remain unknown to them. Yes, I suppose, to some... but if that were taken to mean there is this, the real me,
yes, I think he
that is unknown to them, I think that's wrong.
I think he is saying, well, a dog, my children, know some of me that they love and I give them, but there are other selves or personalities in myself they don't know of.
Oh, sure.
Those are the secrets again.
Sure. That's true. That's so. Thank goodness for all of us. Earlier you asked me about childhood thoughts and fantasies, and I suppose most children, I would have fantasies about being able to read people's minds or about their being able to read my mind. And I remember realizing what a decidedly mixed blessing this would be. In fact, how completely destructive it would be, how if you thought about it a little more, you realized, no, you didn't want to be able to do that. That would not be a good idea.
Yes, I thought a lot about being invisible.
Ah, yes. Not
changing history.
That's
or
right, yes. Yes. Being invisible, it turns out, I think, to be a much more pleasant fantasy than being able to read minds.
Yeah. Okay. We make you invisible now. I thank you for this interview, and I look forward to meeting you again on the 19th of October.
I look forward to it, too. This has been enjoyable.
Dit waren de laatste woorden van een rendezvous dat een dag duurde. Maakt niets uit. Zoals ik het rendezvous door elkaar snijd en de chronologie loslaat, zo monteren onze hersens. Eén voortdurende hermontage. Alles wordt continu door elkaar gesmeten, zoals we later zullen zien. We beginnen om 1:00 in de middag met een vraag die Dennett zichzelf stelde in zijn laatste boek. Hoe kan iets dat ons zo vertrouwd is als ons bewustzijn ons tegelijk zo bizar voorkomen?
Well, I think that is the problem. On the one hand, we seem to know from the inside our minds. We seem to know our minds better than anything else. What could we be more intimately associated with than our own minds? And then when we try to figure out how our minds exist in the world, how they could be, for instance, a function of what's going on in our brains, it seems utterly mysterious. When you look for minds in the world, there don't seem to be any. And yet, we have the sense at the same time that each one of us has a mind, and we certainly know, each of us knows our own mind, it would seem, just perfectly. That is the way it seems. Certainly that's the way it seems. That's the way it's always seemed, I suppose. And that's why it's been so hard to come up with a good theory of consciousness, a good theory of the mind, because that just seemingly undeniable intuition is in some degree false. We're fooled about our own minds. Descartes famously said, the one thing I can't be wrong about is the content of my own conscious thought. Whether it's true or false, that's another matter. But what my thoughts are, and that they're my thoughts, that I can't be wrong about. And oddly enough, I'm claiming that he was wrong about that.
Mm-hmm.
The one thing he said was most certain.
The motto of this television narrative is one of Shakespeare's. We are such stuff as dreams are made on, and our little lives are rounded with a sleep.
There's so many different ways of reading that
yes.
line. One can... one thing that puzzles me is, or delights me in some ways, is that I eventually put together a theory of the mind which says that our minds are, if you like, just as real as our dreams. But that's not real enough for some people. They say, I'm denying that consciousness exists because I'm saying that there are illusory features to it. Illusions exist. What's wrong with the existence of illusions? Yes, I'm saying that the mind is as real as the illusions are that we know to be real. It is, in a way, a sort of illusion itself. Now, to some people, that seems just absurd. They say, well, an illusion to whom? Who's the subject? Who's the victim of this
who's
illusion? There's got to be a self there to be fooled. Aren't we right back to Descartes? And my answer is, no, we're not, actually. We have to build up to this idea gradually, but we can make sense of the idea that what a mind is, in if you like, the brain's user illusion of itself. Now, it looks like a trick with mirrors, but that's what we should expect from a breakthrough here. It should look like a trick with mirrors at first.
Mm-hmm. So, Shakespeare? The sentence, we are such stuff as
dreams
are made on, and our little lives are rounded with a sleep.
Yes. Well, in a sense, I suppose Shakespeare's line, I would interpret so that it came out to be true. What I am, what you are, most importantly, is not just a body, because the cells in your body are changed over many times. You can lose or replace really any part of your body, in principle, even parts of your brain. But if we're going to replace the parts of your brain, we'll have to do it in such a way that what we preserve is Richard Feynman, the physicist, once called the dance,
mm-hmm.
the dance of those molecules. They always dance the same dance. That's what makes you you. And that's the information. So what we are, really, is the information contained in our brains. That's where personal identity resides. And as long as that information is preserved, it doesn't make any difference what the physical substrate is. So in a sense, I think just like a dream could be recorded
yes.
in some way, I could be recorded, put on huge tape banks somewhere,
mm-hmm.
then brought back to life at some later time. Possible in principle, impossible in practice. And that's always important, that it's impossible in practice. Philosophers tend to ignore that. But it's also important that it's possible in principle.
Onderbreek ik Dennett's exegese over het bewustzijn om hem naar zijn kinderjaren terug te voeren. Wat voor jongetje was hij? Hoeveel van de filosoof die hij worden zou, ging er toen al in hem schuil? Welke dromen had hij?
Well, I think like many children, when I was a child, I thought I was unique in this regard, in that I kept stumbling across philosophical ideas.
What kind of?
I invented solipsism. It was a lovely fantasy, the idea that I was the only real self, the only real mind in the whole universe, and all the rest of it was a sort of big cinema set for my benefit, and that when I went home, the school and the teachers and the rest, that just disappeared, or they could just put away for the night or something. I've since discovered that many, many children have this idea. I routinely now ask my students, how many of you dreamt this up when you were little children? And, half the hands in the room will go up. I'll always with sort of embarrassed looks on their faces. But it did fascinate me. Ideas of that sort fascinated me, but I didn't know what a philosopher was, so I had no way of saying, that's what I want to be. I didn't know you could actually do this for a living.
Mm-hmm.
So it wasn't until I was in college, actually, that... that I
dissolve.
Really saw that there was something wonderful that I wanted to do of this sort. And that was when I was a freshman. I like so many freshmen in the United States and probably all over Europe too, I read Descartes' Meditations.
Yes, but before, because we are now going again, too rapidly in the mind state.
We're all right, we're getting too, going through this. Right.
Just remember your childhood. We were children and love was a simple thing. Do you remember this period? What were the odors, the colors, the songs, the music of your childhood?
My earliest childhood memories are from my living in Beirut in Lebanon. My father was a historian by profession, but during the war he was in the OSS, and we lived the life of the diplomatic family in Beirut, Lebanon. So the sights and sounds were quite marvelous. I remember the wonderful smells from the food that was sold by people just on the street would always try to sell me things through the gate, and I was always very eager to buy whatever candy or bread or whatever they were selling.
How did it taste, this candy?
Oh, I remember in particular the sesame seeds. That was one of my first loves, was the sesame seeds that were put on the outside of some of the breads. Also, there was a kind of, to my taste today, disgustingly sweet toffee or taffy that was sold, which I bought, and at the time I rather liked it. And as I recall, this may be a mistake, but it seems to me that I recall that it was wrapped in a piece of wax paper that had on it a photograph of King Farouk of Egypt. Why that should be the case, I don't know, but I have a vivid memory of unwrapping King Farouk from around this brown taffy, popping it in my mouth.
And the colors? The first colors come into your mind, if I say colors.
From that period, I suppose it was just all the lush greens. We had a nice garden around our house, and we had, for a while, we had a tame gazelle that lived in our garden, a gazelle that I had named Babar, not caring too much about species at that point. It seemed a perfectly good name for a gazelle. At that time, I was, if I was a philosopher at all, it was just the way every child is a philosopher, full of wonder and discovering amazing things at every turn.
Yes, such a question as, why are there so many kinds of living things? Did it ever occur to your mind in this? Because that's what's happening with me. You're tremendous, but why so much and so different?
I don't remember that occurring to me. I remember also being transfixed watching a magician who performed on the dock. As we'd taken a ship to go to Lebanon, and when we stopped it, I think it was at Port Said, there were there was a magician performing on the dock, way down below the deck of this steamship. And little boys, naked boys, standing on the edge of the dock, and if you threw coins into the water, they dove off into the dirty water and somehow found those coins and brought them to the magician. And he was doing amazing things. And I've been fascinated with magic ever since then. And I'm not a good magician, but I am...
There is a strong connection, brains, mind, and...
Brains, minds, and magic. Yes, in fact... one of my favorite analogies is a lot of them actually are with magic, because
what you were talking about was, I don't remember exactly, but that modern nature is playing some well, not dirty, but some cheap tricks, and that in repetition of these cheap tricks, magic arises. It's something like that I remember.
Well. There's lots of cheap tricks in nature, but which work. I mean, tricks are cheap. That's cheap tricks is sort of redundant in a way. And as every stage magician knows, you can do a rather small trick, which is almost instantly blown up in the minds and memories of the audience into something that it never was. And then they have a much harder thing to explain than they actually need. So they have too big a phenomenon to explain. I think this is what happens again and again and again with our minds. We think that the phenomena that need to be explained are much more stupendous than they are. And it takes the sort of ruthless, skeptical probing that one uses to unmask a magician, to figure out how the magician is doing the tricks, to uncover the reality and demonstrate how the audience was fooled.
Mm-hmm.
And this, of course, goes hand in hand with an interest in how things work.
Hoe dichter je bij de geest komt, schrijft Dennett, des te opvallender zijn de veelvoudigheid, het niet één zijn en de onderlinge competitie. Tegelijk schrijft hij, ons geheugen voert in de loop der tijd een meedogenloos verkortingsproces uit. Maar op dit moment zit Daniel C. Dennett tegenover me. Laten we daar nou even niet aan twijfelen. Hij vertelt van alles. Maar mijn hersens, wat doen die met al die woorden, die beelden die ik op dit moment waarneem? Ergens in een huis in het noordoosten van de Verenigde Staten.
A philosopher would be foolish to try to answer that question in detail. That's what we need neuroscientific research for. But I can tell you a few things that aren't happening in your brain right now, although it might seem that they were. What isn't happening is that all of these features, the sights and the sounds, I hope no smells, they are arriving in different parts of your brain, and they are having short-term effects, lasting fractions of seconds, maybe in some cases more than a second or two. Most of it...
You also mean words?
Words, yes. Everything that's coming into your eyes and ears, let's just concentrate on that right now. It's being interpreted by specialized parts of your brain. For instance, the parts that are interpreting the words are not the same parts that would interpret music or other sounds. And probably, as you're listening to the words, part of what you're doing, even though you're looking at me, you may also be forming a little bit of mental imagery. For instance, if I start telling you about going to a theater, even though there's no theater right here, you may immediately have some sort of quasi-visual picture of a particular theater that you're, you know, the seats or the stage or something like that. So that as you're hearing words, your brain is engaged in many different ways in comprehending those words. And the outcome is going to be that you're going to forget most of the words and remember what they were about already. I mean, right now, you almost certainly could not report back verbatim what I've just been saying to you, but you could get a very good gist of it. That information is already lost, probably lost forever in your brain. Although, of course, in this case, you've got it on film so that you can, if you really want to know exactly what the words are, you can go back and get them. But as far as your brain's concerned, those are already lost. Lost almost as soon as I said them. They're replaced with something else. There are indeed some long-term effects that are going to be set down. But there's no one place that they're set down. I think it's been a long time that brain scientists have known that there isn't any one part of the brain where memory resides. It's distributed somehow. It's only in the last few years that people have begun to have any models at all that could actually demonstrate the power of a distributed system of this sort to hold large amounts of information, and there's still a great deal that nobody
understands.
The process of recollection is not simply getting the can out off the shelf and opening the can and depositing its contents back into the world. It's always a process of reinterpretation. Even in the case where you seem to be reliving an event most vividly, recalling it in all its details, it's not like a film running in your inner theater.
And time has been screwed out.
Time has been twisted around in various ways, and only the essentials are left, in a way that maybe filmmakers would dream of being able to make a film that could leave out so much detail and still be so vivid. But you can't do it. It's a different medium. It's an entirely different medium. It seems as if there were... I wonder if before motion pictures, if it was so apparently obvious to people that when they closed their eyes and recalled an event from their past, did it seem like moving pictures?
If I say Emmentaler consciousness, and who commands... Well, why are you laughing?
Emmentaler.
Yes.
Yeah, that's nice. It's nice.
Cheese, but...
Yes, right. I got the point of it right away. I liked it. Yeah. I hadn't thought of it in those terms before.
Ons bewustzijn zit vol gaten. Het is zeer spaarzaam met het opnemen van informatie van buitenaf. Het bevat nog niet de helft van wat mensen denken dat hun bewustzijn bevat, schrijft Dennett.
First of all, it's a surprise to people to learn that there are these big gaps in their consciousness, both in space and time. People are stunned to learn that they have a blind spot in each eye, a big blind spot, big enough to hide 6 full moons piled up on top of each other. You don't notice that in everyday life.
So you're not aware of what you're missing?
You're not aware of what you're missing. It's actually a phenomenon which has other manifestations which are in some ways easier to understand. America has the Fort Knox, a fort which is filled with gold. The gold in Fort Knox is presumably supposed to preserve the value of the American dollar. Notice, it doesn't matter that the gold's really there. All that matters is that everybody thinks it's there. It's a phenomenon which depends on beliefs. It's not as if the gold, by gravity or by its weight or by radiating something, makes a difference. Its presence there only matters because it's believed to be there, and it's the fact that it's believed to be there is what plays the role in the economy of nations. Similarly, in your conscious life, what matters is what you think is there. We think of our consciousness as being continuous. We think of it as being non-gappy. We ignore the gaps, and because we ignore them, their presence doesn't make a difference, and that's why it's so tricky to show them. It's because we're sort of so used to ignoring them that it takes a special effort to draw our attention to them.
How do you do it?
See your blind spot. The reason that you don't normally see your blind spot there's several reasons. One is that in order to see the edges, to see the spot, you have to see the edges, and in order to see the edges, you have to have receptors on both sides of the boundary. But there aren't any receptors on the inside of the boundary, so you can't really see the boundary. So the only way you can see your blind spot is by making something disappear into it at a time when you're attending to it.
Yes.
Well, you can do that. You can, very simply, you can close one eye and put 2 crosses, you know, on a screen or on the wall, and you look at one, and as you move your head closer and closer, you get about the right distance, depending on the distance apart of the 2 spots. One of them will suddenly disappear. It's disappeared into your blind spot. That's one kind of gap.
Yes, a memory gap. That is to say, I am unique, and I'm also unique because I'm a real person, but a real past. And the past formed me, and is there always. Not always, not every minute, but at the moment that I want.
Well, yes, if you go to sleep, of course, it's not there. You know, what is it like to be asleep? Everybody knows about those gaps. Also, you know about how those sleep gaps don't bother our sense of continuity. We can, as philosophers, we can reflect, how do I know I'm the same person when I wake up that I was when I went to sleep? How do I know that was I that went to sleep? Maybe it wasn't.
Or Kafka's metamorphosis.
Sure.
Yes.
But it's precisely because we don't find these sudden metamorphoses happening that we're comfortable in our sense of continuity. And of course, in Kafka's story too, he wakes up with all of his memories of what he used to be.
But as a
but with an entirely new and horrible body. Yes.
Yes.
There are gaps in time. In the course of just your everyday conscious visual experience, your eyes are jumping about very fast in a little jump called a saccade. Your eye moves to about 3 or 4 fixations a second. And so there's 15, 20 milliseconds of jump 3 or 4 times in every second. That's not a big gap, but we aren't aware of those gaps at all. But changes that are made during those gaps, we're entirely oblivious of. So these are real temporal gaps in our visual experience.
As you wrote, we will never be able to tell, in fact, that our brains are provisioning us with less than everything that is available in the world.
There's a very simple way of thinking of this. Mother Nature is stingy. Mother Nature is thrifty. Does not go to added expense if there's no reason to do it. Why bother bringing the whole world, that is a representation of the whole world, into the head when, for most purposes, the world's right there. All you have to do is look at it whenever you need it. Leave it there. Don't bother going to all the trouble of representing it and storing a representation of it. It's for the same reason that I don't buy all the books. I buy a few books, and then I go to the library, and I borrow books whenever I need them. Similarly, as you walk around, you get a flood of information from vision and your other senses. You get more information than you can use. That's why you think you have it all, because you never have any hunger. Any information you want, you've got it, bingo, just as fast as that. And since you are seldom put in a position where you crave more information than you get, you have the sense that your information store is just complete.
Yes.
But it isn't, and we can demonstrate that by creating artificial circumstances where we can create that hunger, where you can see that there should be some information that you don't have, and then it can be very stunning, very surprising.
In what way? Astonishing.
For instance, these lovely experiments that John Grimes has done where he shows subjects pictures. These are high-resolution, full-color photographs. He shows them on a computer screen. And they're asked to study these pictures for 10 seconds because they're later going to be asked to identify those pictures, to pick them out of a larger group of pictures. While they're looking at the pictures, a device, an eye scanner, looks at their eyes, and as soon as the eye begins to make one of these saccades, one of these jumps, something big in the picture changes, something really quite astonishingly large changes, but it changes during this brief flick of the eye.
So the brain does not...
The brain does not pick up on this. The brain, and what's fascinating is, even though something quite large has been changed in the picture, the subjects are unaware that anything has changed. Now, if they had in their brain a good copy of that picture, then they would notice a mismatch. They would see that the new picture they had didn't match the old picture. But they don't notice.
And we're talking now about split-second experiences.
That's right.
But what is the implication for thinking about the brain if it is a discontinuity concern?
There are many implications, but one of them is that the brain actually stores and processes and presents less than we think it does. It has a much more modest diet of information than our phenomenology at first suggests. But then we can go beyond that and say, not only that, but the order in which things happen in the brain is not that the order in which they seem to happen. There's quite a difference. The order in which things seem to happen is what we might call the subjective order of events in the stream of consciousness, is much more a function of interpretation than of actual temporal order of the events happening in the brain. Now, this is an idea that we have no trouble with when we run into it in novels and films. Mm-hmm. We understand what a flashback is in a film or a novel. We understand that in a sentence, if the sentence says, Tom arrived at the party after Bill did, we learn of Tom's arrival before we learn of Bill's arrival, but what we learn was that Bill arrived first. There's no problem about that. We recognize how in these forms of representation, the order in which things happen in the representing may not be the order that the representing represents.
Uh-huh.
It actually represents things in a different order. The brain does the same thing. It's quite possible for you to have a brain event which represents A, a later brain event which represents B, but in which the brain represents B as happening before A. That's the way it seems subjectively to you, even though that's the reverse of the order of the events in the brain. That's a very striking idea. I think this is one of the hardest ideas in my book to understand. It's very hard to believe, and it takes a lot of strenuous exercise to show people that they should abandon this idea that the stream of consciousness really is running through a sort of camera, really is being, or a projector, onto the screen.
We're looking in mirrors and mirrors and mirrors, but if you describe this, what is the implication of such a hard-to-believe experience?
Time to quit. All right.
Well, you're thinking about the brain.
In my book, I present a theory called the multiple drafts model of consciousness, which suggests that all of these demons are writing things down in some sort of brain language, these drafts of narratives. That was to counteract an over-reliance on pictures, which is a mistake. But the idea of writing is also a mistake. So let me give you a different version of the same theory, which is in an important regard equivalent, although it has some different images associated with it. We could call this the multiple cuts theory of consciousness, where we imagine a movie studio where they make films, and they've got all these pieces of film that they shoot in any order at all. It doesn't matter what order they shoot it in. And now it's being composed by various editing processes. And first this bit goes before that bit, and then that bit goes before this bit. And maybe you have different teams working on different versions of the same story at the same time. And maybe eventually one of them gets released as a film to the public. Or maybe not. It may just get stored. Now, if you think, yes, but what's the right version? Is it the version where A happened before B, or the version where B happened before A? Which is the version? It doesn't make any difference what order the film was made in. Which is the correct canonical version? Well, you might think, well, if this is a studio that has a boss who's got his own private inner office.
And, central meaner.
The central boss meaner of the whole show. And at some point, he has a private showing, and he sits there in his private theater, and he watches a particular rough cut of the film, and he says, that's it, that's it. Now, if somebody tampers with that film later and changes the order or cuts a scene out, then that's tampering with the official version. What I'm saying is there isn't any official version in consciousness. All the time, our brains are tampering with the contents. They're revising them, editing them. Some things are being forgotten, dropped out altogether. And the question is, what's the version when you were conscious of it the first time? That's a mistake. It's a tremendously attractive mistake, but it's simply a mistake.
Daniel Dennett over de vraag waarom we eigenlijk slapen.
I'm fascinated by recent perplexity on the part of some biologists who are concerned about what the function of sleep is. And they think they've shot down all the plausible theories. It doesn't seem to have this function, it doesn't seem to have that function. And so some of them are saying this is very paradoxical. They can't find a function for sleep, which is such a ubiquitous phenomenon. And they're not even exploring what seems to me to be the obvious first step to any theory of sleep, and that is, they've got the question backwards. It's not what the function of sleep is, it's what the function of being awake is. Why should an animal be awake? Well, it's got to be awake in order to get enough food so that it can live till it can mate, and it's got to find a mate. If it's a sexual creature, it's maybe it's depending on its, again, on its particular way of making a living. It may have to care for its young, it may not. But once you take all its requirements, all its biological requirements, if you can get those all done in 1 hour out of 24, then there's no reason not to sleep the rest of the time. It's cheaper. Yeah. So that we're so used to thinking that the point of our existence is to be awake. Well, that's the point of our existence now. We've taken on this value. But Mother Nature doesn't care. From Mother Nature's point of view, being awake is a luxury. Yes. You don't need that. We don't exist in order to smell the flowers and enjoy the scenery. Those are values that we have adopted and made our own, and that's who we are. To us, a life without being awake is no life at all. Yeah. But those are only our values, those aren't nature's values, and so we shouldn't expect that there should be an answer to the question of the function of sleep, as if sleep was a deprivation of wakefulness. No other creature does anything like laugh. Not, that's pretty clear. What's it for? And if that's, since that's a risky question, one wants to know, what is it a byproduct of that is so important to us? Why should we be designed so that laughter is, in Steve Gould's terms, a spandrel that is so evident in the structure of our cognitive lives?
Yeah.
I suspect, and at this point I'm talking about theoretical ideas that are still very misty for me, that the key to understanding this is to looking at the role of what you might call, well, time pressure and emotional storms. That is, that the way in which our control systems have evolved to overcome the design shortcomings of their ancestors is to pit one part of the brain against another in a sort of tense struggle, which creates the risks of certain sorts of impasses, which need to be resolved by getting a sort of push from some other quarter.
And this is?
And the laughter, the response is simply a byproduct of that.
Yes.
But also, you see, we become addicted to it. Well, no reason why we should have become addicted to it, except that's simply the price we pay for having built our cognitive machinery up as a tinker builds from bits and pieces lying around and put to new purposes. I think that fun and laughter just cry out for a Darwinian explanation,
yeah,
of this sort. That is, it's as if somebody built a homemade airplane that whenever it turned left, rattled just terribly and shook and almost shook to pieces. And if you ask, well, why does it shake so hard when it's turning left? What good is that? It's not good. It's not good for anything. It's just that given the raw materials that the designer used, this was a price to pay for something which was very important. And I think that's got to be the general space in which a good theory of laughter, say, will fall. I think our main dangers are dangers that, in a sense, grow out of our animal past, but very indirectly. I think fanaticisms, for instance, are, by my way of thinking, the single most dangerous feature of human existence right now. And if you ask, why are fanaticisms so potent? Why do they govern people's lives the way they do? I think the answer is in part that we crave simple answers to complicated problems. And that's very unfortunate. As you can see, I'm speaking with a sort of pure 18th century Enlightenment voice at this point. It is, to me, the goal is to impose more reason, set higher standards of rationality, impose them. We're up to it. Human beings are up to it. It's their fears that lead them to adopting and then clinging with a deathly embrace to doctrines which are just indefensible. And I think, actually, part of our Enlightenment heritage of tolerance for this, which has been a very good thing, has been the conditions of its of the flowering of modern civilization, has also been a condition which is now we're seeing that one of the prices we pay for that is an unwillingness to confront some of the ancient myths and just declare them to be the nonsense that they are because we're afraid of hurting people's feelings, we're afraid of offending their religious sensibilities. So it's dangerous.
And at the same time, fundamentalism is going back and religion is taking over.
Exactly. And this is it's the this, the rise of fundamentalisms of every stripe that I think are tremendously dangerous. And I don't think that's our, in any interesting way, our animal nature, except in the sense that part of the taming of the human animal has been to create susceptibilities to certain sorts of fear and susceptibilities to certain sorts of relief from that fear.
Ook vergeten, direct na de ontmoeting, het kinderspelletje dat Dennett met me speelde. Naar aanleiding van mijn vraag hoe je in godsnaam vrije wil kunt inbouwen in een robot of computer.
1, 2, 3, shoot. Ah, we're both scissors. Tie. 1, 2, 3, shoot. Oh, paper over rock, you get me.
Okay.
1, 2, 3, shoot. Paper again. 1, 2, 3, shoot. Ah, rock cuts, okay. Rock breaks.
And this continues.
This continues on and on. Now, if you're playing this, this game, you want to think, what's my strategy going to be? Well, if you adopt a simple strategy, like I'm going to do rock, rock, paper, scissors, I'm going to keep doing that in order, oh, in no time at all, the other side will track that, and then you'll lose all the time because they'll see a pattern in what you're doing. It's important not to exhibit pattern, to be random. But if you want to be random in this way, a pseudo-random process is just as good as a random process. Now, that simple game reveals in very simple terms why there are many actually much more sophisticated contexts where it's important for your brain to be able to randomize its exploration of a set of possibilities. Only thus can you have much protection against being systematically blind to important events in your lives.
Mm-hmm.
I think a large part of free will, of spontaneity, that one of the reasons that we intuitively appreciate freedom is that we don't want to be trackable. And that's right, we don't want to be trackable. You don't want to be trackable. If you're trackable, you're not in charge. It's a very important threat to your autonomy. And so you want to have that freedom built in, but you can build that into a machine.
Ook ter plekke vergeten, en dus niet genoteerd, de avond na het rendezvous met uitzicht op Boston. Ja, pas teruggezien toen de film in Nederland ontwikkeld was, alsof ik het voor de eerste maal zag. Daniel Dennett over de dieren in ons. Schitterend, die neocortex waaraan we ons bewustzijn ontlenen. Maar hoeveel evolutionaire beesten en herinneringen regeren tegelijk mee vanuit de andere hersendelen, de oude.
Oh, certainly, yes. Some, and that's what we commonly say. He's no better than an animal. He's behaving like an animal, and some people do. But aside from people that are like that, what a normal human being, particularly a normal adult human being, is quite wonderfully reliable and safe and wise. Otherwise, we wouldn't go out on the highway. Think of it. We unhesitatingly get in a car, we drive 60, 80 miles an hour on a highway with cars coming at us. The drivers could instantly kill us. We're not afraid of that. Why? Because we trust in the self-control systems in those brains. You put chimpanzees behind the wheel, nobody's going to go out on the highway. I'm not going to go out on the highway, I'll tell you.
Okay, there's the highway. What's happening in Vietnam, for instance, or Auschwitz, or whatever catastrophes we have had this century?
Yes, things break down.
Who's the master of this?
Yes, and there's no one master. Certainly, ancient animal urges rise up, but also urges which I'm afraid are actually much more human than animal. What I'm saying is there isn't any official version in consciousness. All the time, our brains are tampering with the contents. They're revising them, editing them. Some things are being forgotten, dropped out altogether. And the question is, what's the version when you were conscious of it the first time? That's a mistake. It's a tremendously attractive mistake, but it's simply a mistake. Now, the simplest phenomenon, I think, that I've come across that exhibits this is one called meta-contrast. In meta-contrast, here's what happens. Suppose I just were to flash a disc on a screen, nice and bright, flash, 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 flash. You'd see each flash very clearly. Then suppose I simply took a ring, a donut, and flashed the ring right after I had flashed the disc, so that the inner boundary of the ring coincided with where the outer boundary of the disc had been. Now, if I flash the ring immediately, within a few milliseconds of the disc, then what you'll see is that you'll see them together. You'll see a ring surrounding a disc. If I delay the ring until, say, a second has gone by, then you'll see both in sequence. You'll see disc followed by ring, disc followed by ring. But if I get the interstimulus interval, the time between them, just right, say about 120 milliseconds, all you will report seeing is just the second stimulus, just the ring. The disc disappears. It's a stunning effect. Now, how do we explain that? Well, here's one theory, and it's the sort of standard theory in the literature, that all you were ever conscious of, as you say, is the ring, and the reason is that somehow the first stimulus, the disc, doesn't get all the way up to consciousness. It's ambushed on the way up. It's waylaid. Somehow the ring overtakes it and prevents it from ever entering the theater of consciousness. And so you correctly remember that what you saw was a ring, and that's all you saw. Well, here's another theory. You were conscious of the disc, but the ring followed the disc in consciousness so swiftly that it simply erased your memory of that consciousness of the ring. Now we have two theories. One says that the disc never made it into the charmed circle. That's why you don't remember it. The second theory says, oh, the disc made it, but then the memory was wiped clean. There's no difference between those two theories, because there's no way of drawing the line that distinguishes the inner sanctum where what happens there matters. That's the mistake. That's the fundamental mistake of the Cartesian theater, and it's a tremendously attractive idea, and it's just wrong.
Yes. But
a philosopher in discussion with me recently, Michael Lockwood from Oxford, said, perception is the leading edge of perceptual memory. To which I replied, edge? Edge? What makes you think there's an edge? That's the mistake. Eventually, material is deposited in perceptual memory, if you want to call it that. That memory itself may begin to decay very quickly. Moreover, it may get tampered with. But you can't draw that edge in such that you can say, now, it hasn't entered memory yet. Now it's entered memory, and any further tamperings any further adjustments count as a memory disorder. The line between a perceptual illusion and a memory disorder simply can't be drawn. Mm-hmm. Since it can't be drawn in a principled way, we have to give up this idea of this privileged place where the consciousness happens. Of course it happens in the brain. That's where consciousness happens.
Yes.
But there isn't any headquarters smaller than the brain, which is conscious headquarters. That's a mistake. And under normal circumstances, a more or less univocal, unequivocal, coherent, unified story emerges. It's the story I tell if you ask me, well, what did you see? It's the story I can tell myself. But if my demands for precision get high, or if my demands for unity get high, then I run into troubles. The story just only has so much unity to it, and beyond that, it doesn't. Mm. And there just isn't any fact of the matter of how it really was. How it really was in my consciousness, even though I can't tell. That's why metacontrast makes such a good case, because when people see the metacontrast stimuli, they see the disc and they see the ring. And when they just see the ring, and I say, well now, you tell me, or you tell yourself in your inner heart of hearts, did you see the disc and forget it, or did you just see the ring? They haven't any way of deciding that. There's nothing that they can appeal to from the inside, from the first-person point of view, that will distinguish those two. I say, if you can't distinguish it from the inside, and there's no principled way of distinguishing it from the outside, no fact of the matter. There was a time back in the 17th century when clockwork seemed like a good analogy for how the brain worked or how the mind worked. And then later, of course, it was the telephone switchboard.
And now it's the computer.
Now it's the computer.
Yeah.
And people have toyed with the idea that it's holograms and lasers. Each new bit of technology comes along, and people see how to use it as a metaphor for what the brain is. Of course, some people say that's the trouble with all of these metaphors; they're all wrong because the brain cannot be analogized to anything. Mm. That's nonsense. Anything can be usefully analogized. The heart can be analogized to a pump. It isn't just like a pump. It is a sort of pump, however. And the brain is a sort of computer. There is a very real sense in which what brains do is computation. Mm-hmm. And the brain is much better modeled as a computer than as a telephone switchboard. Because, of course, the trouble with the telephone switchboard, at least as the analogy was originally used, is that that was when there were still human operators in there who answered and who knew what the message was.
And now the humans are out.
And the great beauty of the computer metaphor, and the reason that it's not really a metaphor, is that the computer is the first technology that, if you like, eliminates the middleman, that does actual information processing, which before you had to put a little man in the box to do that.
Yeah.
Got to get the ideas to think for themselves. You got to get rid of that middleman. And at the time I was looking at artificial intelligence and was becoming clear to me that that's just what artificial intelligence was working on. That is, and that's what computers did. They eliminated the middleman. They had these elaborate schemes for creating apparent homunculi, apparent inner agents, which were, if you looked at them closely, you saw they were composed of smaller, stupider little agents. And finally, you got down to agents that were so dumb that all they had to do was to remember 0 or 1. And that's an agent that can be replaced by a machine. Then you realize the whole thing can be replaced by a machine. Not in one step, but in a finite number of steps. So the trick is, the old argument looked like an infinite regress. Mm. The trouble with the little man in the head is that the little man's got a brain, and the little man's got a mind, and you're simply going to, what goes on in his brain? Is it going to have a smaller man in the head, and so forth, ad infinitum. The mistake is thinking it's got to be ad infinitum. The way to break the regress is to say, there's not one little man in your head who's all powerful. There's a whole bunch of little men in your head who are partly powerful. And then you can go inside their heads and break them into smaller ones, stupider
ones. And smaller ones and smaller ones.
Yes, but not forever. It's a finite regress, and after some steps, it's pretty clear that the components at this point are just mechanisms.
Yeah, it's like an ant colony, for instance.
That's right. It's you discharge the homunculi one at a time. You posit a sort of intelligence in there, an agent, until you can deal with some other part of the theory. Then you tackle that agent. You say, all right, now I'm going to discharge this one. Yeah. And you break that agent down into some simple parts, and then you break those simple parts down, and maybe after 2 or 3 steps, you've got a mechanical account. You're home. You're finished.
Let op. Ik kan me vergissen. Maar als Daniel Dennett ergens problemen mee krijgt tijdens de samenkomst met de 5 anderen, dan is het met de volgende voorspelling.
I think that a robot could definitely be conscious in exactly, unmetaphorically, the same way that we are. We are a sort of
only
robot. We're organic robots created by a research and development process called natural selection, and also, of course, by a learning process in our own lifetimes. So, as a matter of principle, I am completely confident that there could be consciousness in an artificial device, a robot, say, that lived its life, learned his experiences, and was made of entirely different materials, say, of silicon. Yeah. I don't think we're apt to see that. For the same reason, I don't think we're going to see anybody make a gallbladder out of atoms. I don't think anybody doubts that a gallbladder is just a very, very fancy collection of atoms. But that's not the way to understand gallbladders, and it would be a pointless stunt to try to do it. In the same way, I think there is a sense in which it would be a sort of pointless stunt to try to make an artificial conscious robot. We can understand consciousness, theoretically. We can solve the mysteries and solve the puzzles, too, without actually creating the duplicate without actually creating the real thing. And if what we are interested in is just the utility of such a robot, the answer is no. People with already plenty of people to do those jobs. The robots that are useful aren't conscious. The robots that are useful as mindless automata, as artificial servants in factories and dangerous places and things like that. And the last thing you want is for such a robot, for instance, to be susceptible to boredom or anxiety or fear.
Hatred,
yes. So for practical purposes, we shouldn't make a conscious robot. And in particular, there's no barrier to doing it. Of course, one of the main reasons we shouldn't do it is if we did, it would have the same rights that you and I have, and it would be immoral of us to demand that it go into some dangerous or frustrating or boring place. We shouldn't put a conscious robot any place we wouldn't put a human being. It would have all the rights that we do.
What is necessary to make from a linearly programmed computer a conscious being? Because if you tell us about that, then we know what we are in a certain way.
Yes.
And we leave the path of metaphor.
Yes. To make a conscious computer, you would, first of all, want to make a computer that had the capacity to have the richness of content in real time that we do. That's already a very tall order, and I think only by making using an actual parallel machine would one have any hope of getting enough computation done fast enough so that it could subserve a life in our world at our time scale. No good making a simulation of a computer that runs 1,000 times too slowly. The world will leave it behind. It would have to be programmed in such a way as to permit the evolution within it of indefinitely many levels of self-reflection.
Mm-hmm.
And it would have to be capable of devising new habits in a very simple sense, just new regularities, new proclivities to put contents together in certain ways. It would need to have a natural language.
Mm-hmm. That's all that's necessary to build a computer with consciousness? These are the main...
That's it, except don't underestimate how much I'm saying is involved there. We're talking about enormous amounts of linkage between various parts of the system. We're talking about very wide information channels, and we're talking about a system which is very richly interconnected with the world. I mean, if you look at a home computer, it has ridiculously impoverished input devices. It's just a keyboard and a mouse. That's it. And a disk drive. That's the only way of getting impingements from the outside world in. It is deaf, dumb, blind. It has no sense of touch, no sense of smell. Once you start adding all of these, or you could add some new ones too, the ones that we don't have, perhaps X-ray vision or echolocation like bats. As you add all these channels of input, and as you add locomotion and behavioral channels of output that have to be interleaved, you create a sort of system which we have only the palest copies of in existing computer systems. We're talking about a mammoth, unrealizable system at this time. But if you give me the $100 billion or whatever it would take to create that, I'm going to say yes, and in the end it's going to be conscious. Well, the current myths about consciousness include the idea of a distinguishable separate thing called by some the self, by others called the soul. This is a very powerful idea, even among people who are, for instance, not religious. Among people who are religious, of course, it is an idea that they have a tremendous emotional attachment to, because they think the immortality of the soul, is there life after death, it depends on the truth of this concept. They also think that it's the having of a soul that makes us special, that makes us have dignity, that makes us have moral worth.
Compared to all the other animals and
this is where one gets controversy. Do other animals have souls? It's interesting that murder, for instance, killing a dog is a bad thing, certainly, but it's not murder. It's not murder anywhere in any land. It's only murder if you kill a human being. We distinguish the human species from all others. I think this is right. But I don't think it's right to say the reason that we distinguish the human species from others is that human species have souls, is what Descartes said, and no other animal does. That creates the illusion of a hard and fast, a sharp edge, where there is, in fact, not anywhere near such a sharp edge. There's a tremendous gulf between us and even our most...
Chimpanzees.
Even chimpanzees. Yeah. And it's a morally important gulf. But it is not one that is well described in terms of a soul, or even in terms of the presence or absence of some one feature of consciousness. I think it is just about an obscenity that the very important debates about abortion are cast by so many people in terms of at what instant does the fetus acquire a soul. That's science fiction. That's the worst kind of science fiction, and
it's the most dangerous myth.
I think that's a very dangerous myth, and I think it's time just to say that and say that this is not a variety. This is not a conceptualization of the issues that stands up to scrutiny. There are better ways of settling these issues. There have to be. There are.
But the definition of soul, as we have had it for 300, 400 years, also in religions, sense is nonsense. Can we call
certainly, soul? Yes. I think that the traditional religious doctrine of the soul is nonsense. If some version of it is going to survive in the future, it's going to have to go out on its own. It's not going to get any help from science. It's not going to get any help from philosophy.
Mm.
Now, There's a doctrine which is a close relative of that, perhaps, which is not nonsense, which I myself assert, and that is that what a person is in effect information. That a
particular and abstraction.
It's an abstraction. Yes, what you are is an abstraction. I talk about what I call the self as the center of narrative gravity.
Yes.
And just the way the center of gravity of an object, it's not an atom, it's not a pearl, it's not a bit of stuff. It's a very important abstraction, but it is an abstraction. So what you are, what a self is an abstract object which is definable in terms of a certain set of information. It follows from that, marvelously, that in principle, you or I could be immortal if the information could be preserved, and there are lots of ways of preserving information. This is scientifically respectable. I think you
more
can defend
immortality in it than in current belief.
Absolutely. If immortality is what you crave, then you're much better off with the conception of yourself as fundamentally defined by information rather than as a sort of immutable mind pearl, soul of some sort. That's an incoherent idea.
Yeah.
And it's also incoherent that it could matter. I mean, people are terribly concerned about, will anything matter? Will there be any moral right or wrong if we have a materialistic physical view of the mind as the brain?
Yeah, will you start using people like computers?
Exactly.
If we are
computers? This is a tremendous worry that people have.
Yeah.
And
they're right, their anger or their fear.
They're right to be afraid, but they are. It's preposterous to think that the way to defend against this is to declare that there's a little bit of intrinsically mattering stuff, which is this, you know, which is by definition matters. I mean, that's just playing games. If what we are matters, and it does, it's not because there's this immaterial or material atom, which makes all the difference, and which is the sort of ultimate locus of all the mattering. That's an insane idea. And my promise is that the replacements are better, that when you replace the traditional notion of the soul with a more scientifically respectable notion, you, one, you explain the complexity. You actually explain what makes it wonderful. You don't have to simply declare it's wonderful in a way that can't be explained. You can see why it's wonderful. You explain why it matters, and you explain how the phenomena work.
Also its goals?
And the goals?
The meanings?
Sure. You explain why there is meaning there. And in the same way that I suppose people used to be terribly afraid of the sciences of biology, uh-huh. that they were going to explain what life is.
Yes.
And they did. And it turns out much better than we ever thought. I mean, élan vital is boring compared to what we have learned about what makes things living. Much better story. Now there's something, there's a kind of life you could really revere, you could really stand in awe of the life that we now understand, thanks to modern biology, much better than the sort of ignorant, dumbstruck wonder at living things when you suppose that they have this mysterious vital substance in them or something.
In Noord-Andover leg ik Daniel Dennett een citaat voor uit een brief die ik ooit kreeg van een Oost-Europese schrijver en vriend. We leven niet alleen in verhalen, half afgemaakte, fantastische, dan weer schijnbaar reële verhalen. Nee, we zijn hen. We bevinden ons niet tussen God en het universum, niet tussen de evolutie en het diner om 7:30. We bevinden ons te midden van duizenden verhalen, die allemaal waar zijn of waar hadden kunnen zijn, of die nog bewaarheid kunnen worden. Zodat we tenslotte nooit kunnen weten waar we ons eigenlijk bevinden.
It's tantalizingly close to what I think the truth is, but I have recently learned, somewhat to my dismay, that there are a variety of views which are very close to mine, are very popular, particularly among the literary thinkers, and particularly on the continent of Europe, which I do not want to endorse because they are slightly too radical, even to the point, I think, of incoherence. The narratives that we are, I do think that in a very important sense, our self-narration, our creation of ourselves, is a matter of spinning narratives, and that this is as much a part of our way of dealing with the world as a spider's web is the spider's way of dealing with
words,
the world.
Words,
and we use them in the same way that animals use their nests and their various other ploys. This is the web of words is our way of making our way in the world, and out of this, we construct ourselves, we construct our lives, and the important thing to remember is that we do this not deliberately, for the most part. The stories that we tell ourselves and each other are, for the most part, not a professional storyteller's stories. A professional storyteller is to what we all are, roughly as a civil engineer is to a beaver that's building a dam. Mm. The beaver is not a professional dam builder, but he's a very good dam builder. And doesn't have to think about all the principles. And similarly, the stories that we are, as opposed to the stories that we merely tell, are stories that are not, as it were, professionally crafted, but are sort of emitted by us. This is what our brains do. Our brains govern a process which creates, over time, an autobiography.
Yes, that's what you're saying. Our tales are spun, but for the most part, we don't spin them.
That's right.
They spin us.
That's right, exactly, yes.
Our human consciousness and our narrative selfhood is their product, not their source.
That's right. That's right.
That's rather a kind of rethinking for me.
Yes. Well, I hope it grows on you. it is one has to expect there are going to be some sharp breaks with the past, and there's going to be some novelties, and this is one of them. This is one that I recommend, and I think it's one of the right ones to make. That doesn't mean that anything goes. This is not really a relativistic, subjectivistic doctrine at all. It doesn't mean that you can, it doesn't mean that if you're a murderer, you can tell a new story where you're not a murderer. It doesn't mean that if you're an evil person, you can tell a new story in which you're not an evil person. It doesn't mean that everybody's fantasies about their past are as good as the truth about their past. And those are the outrageous versions of the doctrine that I do not associate with and will not associate with. And I know that they are nevertheless popular in some quarters. This is even a sort of deconstructionist dogma, I gather.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not my dogma. I think that there are principles, and in the end, they're scientific principles which govern the interpretation of these emitted stories. And we can tell. First, we get the story. Then we go and look.
In the beginning was the word.
In the beginning of this task was the word. It's very recent. If you look at the actual history, I mean, words have been around for just a twinkling of time.
Yeah.
But since those words have been around, they have played an ever more potent role in constructing what we are.
Yes.
It's a recent innovation which is very much taken over.
What would you be without words? For instance, a child born deaf, mute, who has no access to sign language or even normal language. What happens?
Well, that's exactly the case you want to look at. What about a deaf, mute child who doesn't have signing? Happily, there are actually very few cases of that, because the deaf children are now, thank goodness, are generally learned sign of some sort immediately as their natural language.
But what happens to these little Kaspar Hausers?
As your question suggests, it's a very important theoretical issue, and here's where we could falsify a theory of mine. For instance, it does follow from my theory that the consciousness, such as it is, of such a human child would be tremendously diminished compared to our consciousness.
Yes.
It would be as different from our consciousness as the consciousness of another species would be.
A real impoverishment.
A real impoverishment. That is just not a normal human mind, even though it's in an almost normal human brain. Now, some people, I think, just recoil from that as if it were somehow an offensive claim. I don't see why they do this. It seems to me to be quite obvious that consciousness grows by degrees in a normal life, a normal child, that the sentience of the fetus in the womb is something which is initially just non-existent and then grows by slow increments. There isn't a moment when the lights are turned on and now you're conscious. And the same thing is true after you're born. The consciousness of the newborn infant is very, very different. Now, one asks, well, how do you know? Well, because I've got a theory which is based on lots of different sorts of experimental evidence from which it follows. But it is true that if such people are capable of the sorts of thought processes that I claim you can only get when you have the virtual machine that grows up with language and so forth, then my theory is wrong. Why should there be, as Tom Nagel once asked, the philosopher Tom Nagel once asked, why should, is there a whole number between one and infinity, which is the right answer to the question of how many selves are there in this?
I am one self. I am unique. Yeah, I am precious. Don't tell me I am 7 or 9 or 11 persons.
Well, that's you talking, but there may be somebody else in there whose voice we're not hearing right now, and that's some other self of yours, who, if it could talk, would say just as much, I am one. Every self is strives for unity. That's why we get multiplication on occasion.
Yeah.
Because what makes a self, in my terms, a center of narrative gravity, is that it is a rationalization. It is a rendering coherent of a set of events, a set of actions, a set of perceptions, and
a set of perceptions. That is the different selves.
Well,
no?
An analogy I like is think about a novel that has a character. And suppose we have a very forgetful novelist who writes about a character named Tom Smith. And then later on in the novel, we hear more about Tom Smith, and we discover that what we learn about the later Tom Smith is not coherent with what we learned about the Tom Smith before. And now we have a problem. Well, is this the same person? Are there two people named Tom Smith here? There seem to be some commonalities, and then there seem to be some differences. We can't make these two pictures coalesce into one picture. Well, now, the principles of coalescing there are principles of rationality. If one of them hates the opera and wouldn't go near the opera, and the other one is an opera lover, we've got a problem, because that just doesn't
match. Frustration of the functions.
That's right.
Yes.
So what we're inclined to do is say, well, really, there are sort of two Tom Smiths in this story. There's the one that coheres around this center of gravity. There's the one that coheres around that center of gravity. Look, their personalities are quite different. Their interests are different. What they know and believe is quite different. You can count on them to behave in different ways.
Yes.
Well, to some degree, that's true of all of us.
But you wrote about this multiple personality
yes.
disorder. Children fleeing from themselves in another self.
Yes.
Just to avoid abuse and
yes.
incest, etc.
Yes.
Is there perhaps a reverse similarity concerning, for instance, the butchers of Auschwitz and Vietnam and all yes. these wars? Afterwards, they always say, oh, they were beautiful, lovely citizens. They loved Rilke and Nietzsche or whatever.
Yes.
They played beautiful Beethoven.
Yes.
And then suddenly they started killing people. Is this a part
indeed,
of the theory of...
Indeed, Robert J. Lifton...
Yes.
wrote about the
Nazi
the
doctors.
Strange power of the Nazi doctors
yeah.
to bifurcate their lives in this way.
But for you, this is a normal view on human consciousness.
Those were not normal people.
No,
but,
of course not.
But that feature of what they did was, I think, a deeply normal human response to the sort of grotesque predicament they were in. We all have a striving for coherence. That's something that's built into us. And as long as our lives are composed of incidents that are relatively easy to keep together into a single coherent stream, then we're fine, then we're
yes.
one, then we're unified. When our
We are not one, we seem to be one, okay?
Is well, yes, we seem to be one. And
We experience ourselves
as one. And because the problems of self-interpretation are not great. They're easily overcome. Now, for instance, as I've been sitting here talking to you, you know, my arms have been moving. I haven't been deliberately moving my hands and making these gestures. But they're easy enough to incorporate into what I'm doing. They make sense in a way that they wouldn't if I suddenly found myself punching myself in the nose or you know, like Dr. Strangelove's arm that goes up and he has to keep pulling it down to his side. Now, when things like that happen, then, immediately, the idea arises, it's somebody else that's doing that.
Yes.
And maybe it is. Maybe I'm a puppet and there's somebody backstage that's controlling me. Or maybe there's somebody in here that's controlling me. And you get, in cases of multiple personality, but also in normal cases, we see, I think, a whole gradation of cases from the sort that you and I are familiar with in our own lives. I mean, There's Dan Dennett, the philosopher and the theorist, and then there's Dan Dennett, the father of teenagers, and then there's Dan Dennett, who's got a farm in Maine and sits on his tractor and mows his hay and so forth. These are these are quite different.
We don masks, we are them. It is to say.
Yes, that's a very dramatic way of putting it. Yes, but yes, it's true. And it's important to realize how big the effects actually are, even in normal people.
Yeah.
I gave a talk at Harvard Medical School, and at the reception afterwards, and I was completely in Dan Dennett, the cognitive science philosopher professor mode. A woman who was catering the reception, putting out the trays of sandwiches and so forth, said, "Oh, hi, Dan, what are you doing here?" And I was completely dumbfounded. This is a neighbor, a friend, a woman I know in another context very well. And I was completely unable to respond to her because I just didn't have that self immediately available at the time. And then I was thrown into complete disarray by this. We all have experiences like that. Nobody wants the story to end. Oh, the story doesn't end. Suppose there were a book of your life in the library of all possible books in Borges's Library of Babel. There is a book which tells the truest tale that could be told of your life from the moment of your birth to the moment of your death. But there's also almost uncountably many books in that library of all the books which tell perfectly true story of your life up to this moment, and they diverge in billions and billions of ways for each future moment. One of those books is the book of your life. Which one? Who knows? Impossible to tell until afterwards which one tells the truest story of your life. Not because our lives are strictly speaking undetermined. I mean, that's an open question. But even if they are determined, we have an epistemic horizon. We cannot see over that in principle, not just in practice, we cannot see over that epistemic horizon. So that's why the future will always be open to us. That's I think, a deep feature of the way the world is. And I can appreciate the offensiveness of the idea of somebody being able to demonstrate what our future was going to be right down to the last syllable that we utter. On the other hand, we're not terribly upset by the fact that science can now say to a moral certainty that you're not going to live to be 150 years old. You're also not going to win the Olympic pole vault. That's just physically impossible for you at your age. It's impossible for me at my age. We don't mind that science tells us about many things which are strictly not in the cards for us, quite beyond the realm of physical possibility. There's still plenty of elbow room for
plenty of room for awe.
Plenty of room for awe, plenty of room for striving, for trying. There's plenty of reason to go out there and have big projects. I mean, there's absolutely no reason why one should think that an implication of this vision of the mind and of human agency was one which had the implication that doesn't make any point to try doing anything. Life is not drained of meaning by this.
More music, more variety, a better mix. Mix 98.5. Have you ever choked on a Cheez-It? Well, I just did, and your eyes turn red. Your face turns blue. Well, that's my story for the day. Here's Eric Clapton.
You know my name. If I saw you in heaven, would it be the same? If I saw you in heaven, I must be strong.
Thank you.